Today, our first presenter is Senior Marcus Brown. Marcus Brown is a physics major from Hastings, Nebraska.
Good morning, everybody. As you said, I'm Marcus Brown, and today I'm going to talk to you about flame dynamics within gas turbine engines. The first part, I'll be talking about my senior project, more related to the turbojet engines. And then later on, I'll talk about the research I did this past summer at the University of Alabama, looking at more of natural gas turbine engines. So first, I'll talk a little bit about gas turbine engine applications. First, we have our commercial turbofan engine. These are the kind of engines you will see if you look out the window in your plane. These usually spin around 10,000 to 20,000 RPM, just to give a little bit of an idea of what kind of relative RPMs we're looking at here. This is our electricity generation gas turbine engine. These are incredibly large and provide power to many of the cities in the United States, and they burn natural gas. And then finally, we have our turbojet engines. These are high-performance gas turbine engines, and these are most famously used for like military applications. As you can see, our jet engine here with our afterburners. It's really fancy and fun to look at. So quick, we can break our gas turbine engines into four major sections: the intake, the compression, the combustion chamber, and the exhaust sections. The first part is our intake, which, as the name suggests, intakes air and forces it into our compression section. Here, the blades increase the pressure of the incoming air and force it into our combustion chamber. Inside the combustion chamber, this is where we mix our fuel and then it is ignited. This adds energy to the gas and increases the temperatures and forces it out as exhaust. And in open-ended gas turbine engines, this provides a net thrust. But in like our natural gas electricity production turbine engines, you might have this cycled back in through our intake. So when the gas is thrown out the back as exhaust, it will crank this rear turbine, and it's connected to a central shaft, and it will spin the intake, so the process starts all over again. So it's kind of like a positive feedback loop. So jet engines use something called the Brayton cycle for their thermodynamic work output system. So if we follow the steps 1, 2, 3, 4, from 1 to 2, we have our fresh air going in through our intake and compression systems. This will increase the pressure, so this is requiring work to be done on the gas. And then it will move in through our combustor, where fuel is added and burned. So we have our Q in. This is our energy. So all that energy that's in those chemical bonds and the fuel are now being released as heat in the gas. And so this causes an increase in our volume of the gas, but it keeps our pressure the same. But what this then is forced out through our turbine, which we get this down curve here, which is our work out. So this is how we get all the benefits of adding that energy to the system, which cranks this turbine and cranks the shaft. So in a jet engine, our work out might be thrust, but in a natural gas electricity generating turbine, this workout could be turning a generator, or turning a shaft that's in a generator or a magnetron, which will generate electricity. And then finally, the gas goes out into the ambient atmosphere, and then the extra heat that it has is dissipated throughout the regular air. So we can first look at our turbojet engines. This is an example of a turbojet engine. This is what I used for my senior project. It's one of the first designs for gas turbine engines because it's the simplest to build. This is mostly because it has no air bypass, so all of the air that comes in through the intake is forced through the combustion chamber and out the exhaust. Whereas like in a turbofan, you might have a huge fan, like that commercial turbofan we saw, it has a huge fan in front, and it might have air byways behind it so it can cool the combustion chamber, which has added efficiency benefits. And so without having the bypass, it becomes much more inefficient, but we get higher performance. So the gas turbojet engines were developed in the 1920s and 30s in Britain and Germany, and then were first used in military applications during the Second World War. And from then on, we always associate our jet turbine engines with our fighter jets and other type of fighter aircraft. This is a Boeing F-15 Strike Eagle, and you have the big afterburners at the end here. To get increased performance at a cost of fuel consumption, we can actually add another fuel spray at the rear by the exhaust nozzle, and since the exhaust is so hot, we can throw fuel in it and it'll ignite for a second time, and so we get the extra thrust. So I do not have one of those big fancy military jet engines, but I do have a miniature jet engine. These were made mostly for hobbyists, which is kind of a crazy hobby thing to do. These things get pretty wild. But this has a rated specification of 40,000 RPM at for idle, and then it's supposed to get up to 152,000 RPM. I don't get up that high because, as I said, it gets kind of sketchy. But then at that highest RPM, I'm supposed to get a max thrust of 100 newtons. But during my senior project, I found that I was only able to get around 60% of this value. It only weighs about a kilogram. It's really light. I have to bolt it down, though, because otherwise it would take off. That's what all this wood structure here is. And then the reason we're able to get to those higher RPMs, as I said, the commercial jet fan only runs at 10 to 20,000 RPM. This will get up to over 100,000 RPM. The reason we were able to accomplish that is because this small diameter at only 9.7 centimeters. If we would have those huge fans spinning that fast, the blades would be ripped apart. We don't have enough centripetal force to keep those blades intact. But when it's this small, that coming in, we can spin a lot faster and still be safe. And I burn kerosene fuel with a jet oil blend mix, but it's not that important. And then we have this is a bisection of a gas turbine engine, or my miniature jet engine. It's a similar model. Here we have our intake fan. This also acts as my compression section because there's not enough room to put in extra blades. We have our combustion chamber here in the center. And then finally, we have a rear turbine right before our exhaust nozzle, which then turns a central shaft back up to our intake. So now I have here's a test run. I don't know if you might have heard me on campus. It gets kind of loud. I tried doing it on the weekends, so it wouldn't hurt anybody, even though at one point we did have exhaust getting sucked up through the vents in the top of the science building and filled the whole building with kerosene gas, so that wasn't fun. But we had my fuel tank, batteries, and a couple DC supplies to charge my the spark plug and my receiver. So here's a video. Right now, I'm pumping fuel into my jet engine, and the kerosene doesn't ignite until you reach about 150 degrees Celsius. So it's heating up right now, and a spark plug is going like inside, but once it ignites, the spark plug will turn off. It's kind of fun to watch. So it's actually running more efficiently when we don't see the blue, but everyone likes to see the blue flames. So the peak there, when it got that really, really high winding sound, that's only at 60,000 RPM. So that's just a little bit above idle. So when this is, that's me having a good time. but when we crank it up to over 100,000, if this isn't locked down, this will actually start lifting up off the ground, which is kind of crazy. So moving away from our turbojets, we're going to start talking about our electricity production gas turbine engines. This is more related to the research I did this past summer at the University of Alabama. One of the major reasons we're looking at natural gas for gas turbine engine electricity generation is natural gas has recently passed coal-based electricity in 2016 and provides the United States with about a third of all of our energy needs. And this is expected to increase in the next few years. The percentage is supposed to increase in the next few years. And it produced about 1.36 trillion kilowatt hours, which is a lot of electricity. And then this is used as a bridge between coal-based or fossil fuel-based energy supplies versus renewable, as it burns at a much, has less emissions. But it does have drawbacks that it releases methane, which actually has a more harmful effects via greenhouse gas, has a higher greenhouse gas effect than carbon dioxide. But it's still generally thought of as a bridge between the renewables and fossil fuels. Also, another reason why they're interested in using it is there's very quick on and off times. So let's say we are able to reach a point where all of our low energy needs can be sustained by renewable energy. Let's say everyone gets home at 5 o'clock and we need a ton, everyone turns on their appliances and need energy right away, you can kick these on pretty fast and meet that energy need. So what I looked at was trying to reduce our emissions in these natural gas engines by using lean premix fuels. So just a quick overview of what lean premix fuels is. So when you mix, you don't just put straight natural gas into the gas turbine engine. You have to mix it with air. And when you have less fuel, like natural gas, it becomes more lean. But then when you have more fuel, it becomes more rich. So we're running at a much leaner equivalence ratio. So if it's below 1, down here, this is the center, this is equal parts air and fuel. This is the lean portion. And when it burns at a much lower temperature, and it releases much, these are all emissions, it burns, releases fewer emissions. One of the biggest emissions benefits is that it has a drastic reduction in nitric oxide. And this is a emission that the FFA and EPA really hound on commercial jet companies to improve their engines. Woo! But it is susceptible to something called a thermoacoustic instability. And I'll show you what those are. So some of the positive effects of the instability is it can cause component damage, increase the harmful emissions, so we negate any of those benefits that we once had. And it caused a drastic increase in noise. And so what we were hoping to use is this porous insert that would be placed inside the combustion chamber. And when we did that, we would be able to mitigate these thermoacoustic instabilities passively and over a wide range of conditions. Because right now, the only way to solve this problem is doing like active methods, where they'll have sensors inside the combustion chamber and be like, oh, we have this equivalence ratio at this temperature, we need to compress it or change the flow rates, and it's really expensive and not very efficient. Or they do have other passive methods, but it's only for this specific equivalence ratio and this specific flow rate. So we're trying to do over a wide range. So this is what a thermoacoustic instability can do to your combustion chamber. You're not fixing that. That's a total replace. So it increases, it has those drastic increase in vibrations and elevated temperatures. So we want to reveal the challenges to how we can make the porous insert reliable and safe use to stop these instabilities from occurring. So our hypothesis is if we place this porous insert in a combustion chamber, we should be able to mitigate it passively and over a wide range of conditions. So this is our experimental setup. Part of it. We have a quartz crystal tube, which will be acting as our combustion chamber. So at the base here, we have a swirl-stabilized combustor. So we'll be pumping natural gas up through this pipe here and igniting it here. And then we'll be able to change flow rates and equivalence ratios as time goes on. And then this has something to do with, this is an optic sheet laser. I'll talk about that later. It's kind of cool when you see it. But So looking at a couple schematics, this is like diving into the meat of the system here. This is the central recirculator. So this is without the porous insert. So if we look at flow fields or vortices inside the combustion tube, this is our central recirculation zone, and then we have our two corner recirculation zone. The central recirculation zone is when, if this is where the instability happens, so once this goes unstable, the whole flame loses its structure and we get the instability. But the corner recirculation zones help mitigate these instabilities and keep structure, but on the same side, this is also where the instabilities originate from. They'll get some instability here or some turbulent flow and it'll flip up into the central recirculation zone. On the other side, this is a schematic showing what our flow rates would be with the porous insert. So we'll have gas coming up through here and flowing into our porous insert and flowing up to the top and then hopefully combusting at the top. And when we do this, we'll provide enough heat here that will shift our corner recirculation zones a little bit higher, as well as our central recirculation zone higher. And what this does is it allows any kind of turbulent flow that would originate there to very quickly flow out of the combustion chamber without really getting a hold of that central recirculation zone. So this is our equipment setup. At the top, we have our plifflet. We did three different high-speed cameras, all looking at different dynamics of the flame. At the top, we have our plif laser, which is our planar laser-induced fluorescence. And that is attached to a high-speed intensifier with a UV lens. So this will allow us to see OH molecules, so we can see where the flame has already have occurred. So during combustion, it will release like an OH molecule, and then it'll turn into water right away. But we're able to shoot it with a laser, and it will fluoresce, and we can see that. On the side here, we have our high-speed color camera. And then at the bottom, we have our PIV high-speed camera. This allows us to see the vortices and all the flow fields. And this is used in relation to our high-power laser here. It'll shoot a regular beam. This is really powerful. We actually shot a laser through our laser protection shield. So we're like, well, that wasn't money well spent. And it goes through an optics, a sheet optics, which turns like a laser beam into like a sheet, so we can see like a planar image. So this is a video with our high-speed color camera, and this is without the porous insert. As time is going on, it's getting richer and richer equivalence ratio, and you see how that flame bounce and establish itself in the corner. This is how our corner recirculation zones have established themselves. So this is helping the flame stay stable. And when it's reached the higher equivalence ratio, it gets hotter and hotter, the flames are going higher, and see that big burst of flame? That's the instability occurring. There's not a lot of structure anymore. And when you're inside the room, you have to have ear protection. The quartz crystal almost shatters. It gets really, really loud. But then if we slow that down with our high-speed camera, again, this is running at around 10,000 frames per second. These are what we see, this oscillating flame, which is about going around 400 hertz. We'll have an ignition, and the flame will go up, and then we'll have a little bit of backflow. It'll go back and reignite the base. So we have this boom, 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 boom. And this is where we get those pressure differentials, and this is what causes all the vibrations and the sounds. So if we can figure out we had never seen this before until we had just done this high-speed camera work. So we are now trying to figure out why there's a separation between the flame leaving and then having the backflow come back. So if we can get that to just be a continuous burn, we can mitigate the pressure differentials so we can reduce the sound. So this is when we put the porous insert inside. Again, as time goes on, we're adding more and more fuel, so the equivalence ratio increases, so it's more likely that we're having instability. So what you can see is we get a little bit of these flamelets down here on the corners. You can see them. This is providing heat to the sides, so we're able to keep the flame more stable. It's getting a little bit heated on the inside there, which is an issue because we're having our fuel combust inside the porous insert instead of atop it. So what we're going to try to do in the future is have smaller pore sizes so that there's not enough air inside to actually combust until it reaches the top, so all of our flame, all the fuel that enters the porous insert, porous medium, doesn't combust until it's at the top. And as you can see, we did have an instability, probably because of the large pore sizes, but it happened at a much later time, so it would have gone unstable much sooner without it. So now we're looking at our planar laser-induced fluorescence. This is our plif laser. This is looking at the OH intensity. So this is like our OH intensity. So we can look at this as the intensity of the flame. So we broke each oscillation into six different segments. And at our 0 degrees here, there's almost no flame. So that's like when the flame is completely extinguished on that oscillating flame that we saw. And then we build, and then we quickly die off. So this is, again, showing the big pulsating system. The reason why our flames look biased to one side is because this side is the side that the laser is blasting through. So we pick up all the OH molecules over here, and then it kind of trails off. But then, so now we're going to put the porous insert inside and see what we get. Now it's a little bit more blotchy and a little bit more consistent. As time goes on, we don't have the drastic pressure fluctuation, although there is a big drop-off from 300 to zero, but I don't really know why that's the case, but it doesn't have the for sure build, and total cutoff. And this probably has to do with those larger pore sizes. So now we're looking at our PIV laser system. we're able to see flow fields. And so this is a jumbled mess. There's vortices everywhere. You can't really make out a whole bunch. So I took a frame out of that, and you can see, you can kind of see with the, if you look closely, there's a coronary circulation zone here, where the arrows are pointing which direction the particles are moving. And then there's a really nice coronary circulation zone there. So you can see that the when this is running in real time, these coronary circulations kind of flow up, and they mix in with this coronary, or the central circulation zone over here. So this is when it's gone in stable. And then this is with the insert. You can see this giant channel down here in the middle that has the low velocity particles. And we don't really have too many vortices. All these arrows are generally pointing straight up, which is really good. Occasionally, so I should say that the red means it's flowing a lot faster, where the blue is a lot slower particle velocities. And even there were a couple of vortices looking back through, but they quickly flew out of the combustion chamber because everything else around it is also pushing it up, which is nice. So future work, what we'd like to do is kind of look at actual gas turbine engine conditions. So we are just doing ambient air temperatures and ambient pressure, but we'd like to do a preheated air and an increased pressure to kind of mimic the conditions inside a real gas turbine engine. And then finally, we'd like to use a nickel-based alloy for our porous insert because we can print smaller pore sizes. And so that's kind of a field that's really allowing us to do more things is the 3D printing with metals. So they can have like just like a regular paper printer, but it just oozes out liquid metal, and then it can make crazy designs, which is kind of cool. And it also has improved heat tolerance, this Inconel material. So in summary, we can see our high-speed images support the claim that the porous insert helps mitigate these thermoacoustic instabilities. We learned that lean premix fuels may be able to bridge the gap between fossil fuels and renewable resources. And gas turbine engines can vary greatly between different applications. So I'd like to make a couple acknowledgments. First, the University of Alabama, and I actually had a grant with NASA and the National Science Foundation working with the natural gas turbine engine research. And then I also wanted to thank the Hastings College Physics Department and Dr. Stephen Beaver as my advisor for my senior project, and as well as the Nebraska NASA Space Grant Committee for providing me funds to purchase my gas turbine engine, which is mine to keep, which I'm happy. Thank you so much. Any questions? Yes, Dr. Beachley.
Can you look at what would happen if the base of the combustion chamber
was? Actually, that's one of the things that we had looked at for our porous insert. We had found that this is actually one of the earlier designs of the porous insert. So if you would, the one that we have that we did our test on, these actually do angle as a conical structure down because we found that helps guide the flames, actually controls them better. When we have the big break off, they had just changed right before I'd gotten there. They were not able to get such smooth flow fields up. So this is a little bit older schematic. But we do now have the conical shape down the nozzle, which is a good thing. Yes?
So that force you put in, is there a chemical reaction happening, or is it just a physical barrier?
It's just a physical barrier that changes the flow. So the fuel will come through the dump plane, and it'll be some of it, most of the fuel will just go straight up through the center. But then some of the natural gas will get sucked into those pores and flow up to the top because they're kind of protected, and then they won't combust until they're at the surface. So that gives us our small flamelets on the top. That's a good question. Yeah. Oh, yes, Dr. Mountford.
You said that the next step would be to make your filter because you don't get enough canards.
No.
out of nickel?
Yes.
What are they made of now?
Oh, I forgot to mention that. This is a titanium oxide. So it was a titanium material, and I think there might have been something else mixed in with it, but it was essentially, there's two different ways of making a porous material. So one is you can just have a solid block and just pump a bunch of air into it and let like little tiny bubbles form. But what we did is we had little 2 millimeter rings all layered on top of each other. So we had a little machine. Well, we paid people to make this insert where we took like a ink jet thing where they would make little tiny circles and layer them on top of each other of this titanium material. And so that was kind of cool. I wish I was able to go see them when they did that. But. Any more questions? If not, thank you so much.